Well, hi, friends. This is Matthew Dowling, preaching minister for the Plymouth Church of Christ, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to the Holy Spirit Seminar once again. And I have a special lesson for us this week titled The Renewal That the Holy Spirit Brings You. I want to begin with a little bit of a story to kind of get us into our study together. There is a show called Clean House, which is probably not familiar to many people. It's the name for a show on the Style Channel, where different experts in cleaning and organizing and remodeling, even painting, they kind of sweep into a cluttered home with the purpose of leaving it more comfortable and more attractive and livable. And the challenge behind the program is that these experts, they come in and there's like clothes strewn across the floor, there's bulging cabinets and closets filled from top to bottom with stuff, there's filled countertops and overflowing kitchens and bedrooms and bathrooms and living rooms, and there's not a clean room in the house. And the expert's first step is to take an inventory of all the stuff there, and then decisions are made about what to sell at a yard sale and what to keep. And the home's inhabitants, they hesitate and hold on to their favorite clothes from years gone by, and they want to keep childhood keepsakes and different things, and they try to keep the experts from really working there, but then eventually they yield. And then there's a sale, and the sale is held, and money comes in to help with the makeover, and then the family leaves, and the work begins. And rooms are cleaned out and redone for more efficiency and attractiveness and repainted. Curtains are hung, cabinets set in, and walls decorated, and a transformation takes place. And when the family returns, they can't believe how much better everything looks. And you kind of notice in this show that nervous anticipation quickly gives way to excitement and laughter when the family sees what's taken place. Well, in the spiritual realm, and now let's think about our own lives, okay? There comes a time for each of us to kind of take inventory in our own lives, to get rid of some things and to do some repairing and remodeling, and frankly, we need to often clean house too. And like the families on the show, we actually have available to us a kind of expert, if we want to call him that, who's expert in remodeling and renovation, and that is the Holy Spirit. Not to be crass in any way towards the Spirit, but the Spirit is the one who can make our makeover a kind of outstanding success. And the fact is, for each and every one of us, there comes times when we need a fresh start with God, where we can sweep out the old junk and bring the new stuff inside. If you have your Bibles with you, open up to Titus chapter 3, verses 5 through 6. And I want to think about this fact that we really do need renewal, renewal by the Holy Spirit. Titus 3, 5 through 6 says that he saved us, God did, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. And he saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Now, this rebirth and renewal that we're talking about was given to us initially when we became Christians. But the fact is, there is even an ongoing act of renewal that needs to take place on a regular basis as we live the Christian life. And for this study together, I want to notice that there are four areas in particular that I like for us and recommend to you to pray to God for the Holy Spirit's power of renewal. And I'm hoping that these four areas will become prayer areas when you go into your war room. And I commend you to do that today. The first area we want to talk about is really a request to the Lord. It is, God, give me a new heart. Give me a new heart. Now, biblically speaking, we need to understand that when we talk about the heart, we're talking about the seat of our emotions, the place where we either invite God in or we try to kind of keep him away and shut him out. And often, when we first become Christians, we do have a heart that's open to the things of God, and we're spiritually hungering for his word. You know, in those heady days when we first became Christians, we can't often imagine a time when we would not want to have a heart that's ready and willing to receive whatever it is that God has to give to us. But it's often the case, and I've seen this in my own life and other people's lives, that somewhere along the line, some of us choose not to hear from God the way that we once did. And our ability to be spiritually sensitive, it seems to disappear. We find ourselves going through the motions. We attend church, maybe even reading the Bible and praying, but not having the ability to hear God really any longer. I'm reminded of the words of Christ in Matthew 15:8 when he said, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away." You know, that's a very convicting passage because it forces us to examine our hearts under the light of God's Spirit. Am I really praying to God, or am I just mouthing empty words? Am I allowing this lesson right now to change me, we might ask, or am I just politely taking notes that I'm going to throw away? Am I going to God's Word with the intent of learning what God has to say to me, or do I go to His Word just so I'll be able to kind of check that off for a day on my daily Bible reading schedule? If someone else had the ability to examine my heart right now, would they see a heart that's drawing closer to God or a heart that's really pulling farther away? Now, I don't know where you're at on those questions and kind of where you are spiritually, but the good news is that if your heart is far from God today, the Holy Spirit can bring renewal that will help you to draw close to God all over again. Listen to these words from 2 Corinthians 1, verses 21 and 22. Paul says, "It is God who gives us, along with you, the ability to stand firm for Christ. He has commissioned us, and notice, he has identified us as his own by placing the Holy Spirit in our hearts as the first installment of everything he will give us." Dear friend, if you are a Christian, the Holy Spirit is already present in your heart. Now, it's just a matter of allowing Him to do the work of renewal. A lot of times when I think about God doing renewal in my own heart, I have a special time in my prayer and devotional life, where I will pray the same prayer that David prayed in Psalm 51:10. In Psalm 51:10, David prayed this way. He said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me." And dear friend, that is where we must begin also. We must pray to God to give you a new heart, to renew you, to give you the ability to hear and to see Him again. We need to admit to God that your heart has not been right in the right place, okay? But that you know with His help, it can be made right again. And if you really want to experience spiritual renewal, it has to begin right here in the heart, okay? With you willing to open up to God and to confess to Him your heart's condition. And the Bible promises as we do this that the Spirit will begin to do His work, reviving what was once so strong and true and making it whole again. So we need to ask God first, and this is the first area, we need to ask God to give me a new heart. The second thing, or the second area that we need to work on, is we need to ask God to give me a new attitude, okay? Now, just to get into this, let me tell you a story. Perhaps you've heard of a man by the name of Donald Drusky. It's the man known as the one God took to court. The one-time employee of the company U.S. Steel blamed God for failing to rectify the wrong done to him when he was fired in 1968. Now, Mr. Drusky waged a 30-year battle with the steelmaker, U.S. Steel, before deciding to actually take legal action against God himself. And I want you to hear the description of the lawsuit that he brought against God. Quote, "The defendant, God, is the sovereign ruler of the universe and took no corrective action against the leaders of his church and his nation for their extremely serious wrongs, which ruined the life of Donald S. Drusky," end quote. Isn't that incredible? So for damages, Mr. Drusky asked for the return of his youth, the skill of a great guitarist, and the resurrections of his mother and his pet pigeon. This is True life. You can Google this. Mr. Drusky hoped that God would fail to appear in court, allowing him to win the case by default. Thankfully, of course, his case was declared frivolous and it was thrown away by a Syracuse court. Now, while Mr. Drusky obviously took extreme measures, I don't think his attitude towards God is all that uncommon, which is why I tell this story to begin this second area's reflections. You see, many people tend to blame God for everything that's gone wrong with their lives, while other people tend to get upset if God doesn't answer their prayers exactly the way they think that he should. And then, of course, there's another group of people who don't necessarily have a bad attitude towards God, but have a really bad attitude often concerning people in general, or maybe specifically toward a boss or a spouse, etc. Now, when my attitude towards God or others isn't right, the fact remains that my spiritual life is also going to begin going kind of down the tubes, if I could put it like that. It's for that reason that the Apostle Paul says the following in Ephesians 4, verses 22 through 23. He says, "Throw off your old evil nature and your former way of life, which is rotten through and through, full of lust and deception. Instead, there must be a spiritual renewal of your thoughts and attitudes." What Paul here is saying is really important. We need to understand that when Paul wrote this, he was addressing it towards people who were already Christians, which just goes to show that this attitude problem, well, it's not really anything new. But notice, what does Paul tell us to do about it? He says to throw off like dirty clothes the attitude that you have. And then we are to enter into the process of spiritual renewal. So my friend, if this is a problem in your life or in mine, we need to go to God and we need to say, God, and I think you can pray just like this. Just say, God, my attitude stinks. Please help me by the power of the Holy Spirit to become a new person. And show me how to look at you and look at other people through your eyes instead of my own. I remember some years back, I recognized that I struggled a bit with attitude issues, particularly towards people. For some reason, I think I was going through a period of discouragement. And I remember asking God in my prayer time, please let me see people with your eyes. And I will tell you, dear friend, that was a prayer that the Lord was faithful to answer. And he really did a work in my heart and softened my heart towards people. So if you struggle with this, I want to commend you to really ask God to give you a new attitude. So that's the second area we need to study in our lesson. Now, I said there's four areas, so let's move on to number three. And this area is simply, we're going to ask God to give me new desires, a new desire. And let me tell you another story just to kind of get into this particular reflection. The year was 1999, and for the first time in 47 years, local fishermen discovered that tuna fish were running only 30 miles off of Cape Cod, Massachusetts. And these fish were really biting. In fact, they were biting so aggressively that you didn't really have to be a professional to catch them. All you needed was a sharp hook and some bait. And the rewards for getting hold of these tuna were pretty substantial. In fact, Japanese buyers were willing to pay $50,000 for a large bluefin tuna. And as a result, many ignored warnings, particularly from the Coast Guard, and headed out to sea 30 miles offshore in small, under-equipped or unequipped boats. And what these new fishermen didn't realize was that the problem isn't catching a tuna. It's actually getting it into the boat. And one particular boat that had an issue with this, a call came in on September 23rd when the Christy Ann, a 19-foot boat, capsized while doing battle with a tuna. In fact, on that same date, September 23rd, there was a 27-foot boat named Basic Instinct that suffered the same fate. And another boat called Official Business, a 28-footer, was swamped after it hooked on a 600-pound tuna. The fact is, the tuna simply pulled it underwater. These things are like 600 pounds of solid muscle. And what happened was, is these inexperienced fishermen, they underestimated the power of the fish that they were trying to catch. Now, what does this story have to do with God giving us a new desire? Well, something very similar to what happened to these unequipped boats happens to us when we give in to sinful desires, okay? A small, Indiscretion appears to be worth the risk, but it's only after we give in that we really discover the true strength of sinful desire. So wouldn't it be great if after we became Christians, all that we would desire would be the things of God, that we would no longer have sinful desire? Wouldn't it be great that we would never be pulled in by sin, that we would never look back at our life before Christ longingly, and that all we would want are things that are pure and holy and true and just? Now, that would be awesome. But you and I know actually that's not how it works. I mean, it seems like only moments after we accept Christ that we find ourselves desiring what the old sinful nature really wants us to again. For that reason, Paul says this in Galatians 5, verses 16 through 17. He says, "I advise you to live according to your new life in the Holy Spirit. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The old sinful nature loves to do evil, which is just opposite from what the Holy Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite from what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, and your choices are never free from this conflict." Now, I want you to listen to that last piece of scripture I just read and think on it. Paul writes, "Your choices are never free from this conflict." You know, Paul says, but he began by telling us that we can rely on the renewal of the Spirit during these times of temptations. And yet he says, even as we do so, our choices will not be free from this conflict. Let me ask you, dear friend, have you ever, in the midst of being drawn into a sinful desire, stopped and prayed to the Lord? I don't know if you've ever done this, but if you haven't, the next time you're really facing temptation, sinful temptation and desire, I want you to stop everything that you're doing, and I want you to begin praying this way. You just say to God in your prayer time, "God, I am failing here. I am tempted by sin, and I feel myself giving into it. Please empower me by your Spirit to overcome this right now." My friend, I want to tell you, I've done that many times, and I believe that every single time I've prayed that prayer, God has answered my prayer mightily. Okay, it's only when I don't pray that prayer and ignore the promptings of the Spirit that I give into the desire that I have. If we, and here's the point, if we will only stop ourselves before sin takes over and pray, I believe the Spirit will renew us and give us the power to overcome what Satan is really throwing at us. So in this third area, we pray, "God, grant me a new desire and help me stop sinning." And then finally, our fourth area in this lesson is, "God, give me a new hope." Another story to get us into this. There was a woman by the name of Barbara Clark, and Barb Clark said to her grandson Josh, 4 years old, who was visiting with her one day, and she told him he could have cereal and pancakes or waffles for breakfast. And he thought a moment and he looked up at her and asked, "Did you say cookies?" Now he was experiencing hope, wasn't he? Cereal, pancake, or waffle, she offered. And he asked, "Did you say cookies?" I love it. You know, for some of us, the problem is that when we started our Christian adventure, we were filled with hope. But the fact is, many things happen in our lives, and many of these things often happen to change our hopefulness. Perhaps it is just life in general, or maybe something has traumatically happened to you to challenge your belief system, or maybe you just forgot to focus on the future God has planned for you. Whatever it is, somewhere along the line, many of us have lost our hope. Paul says in Romans 15, verse 13, this, he says, "I pray that God, who gives you hope, will keep you happy and full of peace as you believe in him. And may you overflow with hope through the power of the Holy Spirit." Now, what kind of prayer is this, we might ask, Paul? A power for prayer? Yes, it is. A prayer for strength? Yes, it is. A prayer for comfort? Yes. But a prayer for hope? Is that really something that we need to be praying for? Do we need to ask the Lord for hope? You bet it is, dear friend. When's the last time you asked God for hope in your prayer life? You know, as I was thinking about this lesson, I thought, you know, I don't know that I pray for hope all the time. But because I think we often don't realize that that is something that God will give us. Because until we experience a renewal of hope, the other things aren't going to matter all that much. If I have strength but no hope, what is that? If I have comfort but no hope, do I really have comfort? So I ask for hope. And the fact is, until we believe in God's future, what He has planned, and until we understand that a better day is coming, and until we begin to see things through the eyes of heaven, we're not going to be able to overcome in these other areas that we've been talking about in these lessons. You see, we need to know that God is real and that heaven is just down the path of our lives, that we will spend our eternity somewhere, dear friends. If we are going to be able to deal with the life that is here and now, we need to know about this future and have hope. You know, as human beings, we are created to look towards the future. And if we are not convinced that that future is something much better than what we have now, we are going to want to give up. But the point of today's lesson is this. Through the renewing power of the Holy Spirit, that kind of hope can be ours. The fact is, we need to pray along with Paul, God, give me a new hope, one that is sure and exciting and real. Give me an assurance of the future, we need to pray. And help me to believe that everything that you promised me is going to come to pass. And I believe if you will pray that prayer, dear friend, God will give you exactly what you ask for, if only you'll trust in Him. I thank you for joining me for this lesson in the Holy Spirit seminar. It's been a pleasure to be with you again today. And I invite you to return next week for another online video class in the Holy Spirit seminar. We really only have one or two classes left. And so thank you for being part of this journey with me. And until next time, dear friend, may God bless you.